Now I'll just walk through what we at Champlain Water District did with one of our main lines leaving our water treatment facility and serving our transmission system. Get into a little bit about why we landed where we did and some of the results. So just to give you a little quick background about CWD, we are Vermont's largest water supplier. We are a wholesale water supplier to about 12 municipalities in the northwest corner of Vermont, in the Chittenden County area. We went online in April 1973, and that's kind of key because that is basically when we built our transmission mains. I'll get into that a little bit to kind of explain and set the tone for what we're trying to do. We have about a 70 square mile county service area. There's about 25,000 connections within the service systems that we have, and there's about 75,000 customers serviced from our wholesale supply. So when we were built, we built about 54 miles of transmission mains. They were installed from 1972 to 2018. So in the grand scheme of pipes, that is very young. So I know a lot of people out there are dealing with pipes dating back to pre-1900s. We're fortunate enough to have pipes that are 46, almost 47 years old, which is young in the pipe world. So most of our pipes are 24 inch, but we do have mains that range from 12 to 30 inches. And most of our mains, about 90% of it, is ductile iron. Class 51 tended to be the majority of the thickness that we put in for our mains. And until we got into the late 90s, early 2000s, most of that pipe went in not poly wrapped. So being young, we are fortunate, and knock on wood, that in the history of our system, we've had only 9 breaks on our mains. Three of them were actually the result of either an electric utility or some other entity boring or coring into our mains. So when you look at it, we've had 6 leaks that have been the result of some sort of a pipe failure. So you kind of sit back and wonder, well, what are you really concerned about? Well, a lot of our mains, our transmission mains, go by our neighboring distribution system mains. And those mains date back into the 40s, 50s, maybe some a little older. But a lot of them are cast iron mains. And what we're seeing with those, and what you can see with the two pictures here on the right, are corrosion that they're experiencing related to the soil conditions. That is the same soil conditions that our mains are in the same vicinity as these events that are occurring. And so what we're also seeing that we're getting corroded bolts on our valves. So right now, our biggest issue seems to be we're going out and replacing valves and packings in our bolts. So what that has led us to believe is that, assuming that corrosion is linear, we are on some time frame for when we would likely see corrosion issues, knowing that the neighboring systems are seeing those issues currently. So we wanted to be proactive, not wait until we started having issues. So we developed what we call a pipe integrity program, or PIP. We took a look around to kind of see what kind of goals we wanted to establish for that. We do a lot of work with the Water Research Foundation and the Partnership for Safe Water. The Water Research Foundation, in their survey, they found that on average, there's about 0.21 to 0.27 breaks per mile per year around their surveyed systems. The Partnership for Safe Water has established a goal of 0.15 breaks per mile per year. Being a transmission system provider of wholesale water, and being where we are currently, we have a goal of 0 breaks. Sounds kind of radical, but it's something that's we take very seriously, because we believe that every one of our service systems is important and critical. So we're trying to shoot for 0 breaks per year. And how we want to achieve that is through trying to discover leaks before breaks, the LBB approach, where we know that these pinholes that may be out there, maybe we're not seeing anything catastrophic currently in our mains, but there are likely some leaks out there, and those small leaks with exposure to corrosive soils and corrosive conditions over time become bigger holes and then eventually become a big break. So one of the things we really want to try and do is find those small leaks before they become a problem and address them. So it led us down a path of how do we inspect them, because buried infrastructure out of sight, out of mind, but buried below the ground and unable to get to it. So what technologies are out there and how do we inspect them, and then how do we develop a program to fix what needs to be fixed and or rehab, repair, replacement? How do we develop that kind of program? So we started out with trying to estimate and quantify what our risk failure might be. So we took a risk-based approach to specify and quantify our risk. Basically, we took a look at the likelihood of failure of all of the 54 miles of main in our system. If trying to look at different conditions, we looked at soil corrosivity, we looked at historical breaks of our neighboring system, and we looked at all other different factors that might impact the failure. Age, which isn't necessarily always an indicator, but trying to use age as one of the factors, giving them different weightings and coming up with a likelihood of factor estimate on a scale of 1 to 10. We did the same thing with the consequence of failure. We ranked them from 1 to 10, 1 being least critical to 10 being the most critical. And in doing so, you take a look and say, not that any customer is less important than another, but from a criticality standpoint, you try and take a look and say, if I've got a line that serves 5 homes at the end of a dead end, and if that fails, how critical is that versus a line that serves a hospital or a school or some large industrial user? So we went through using the risk equation, where risk prioritization equals likelihood of failure times consequence of failure, populated that for all of our mains, came up with the scattergram that you see on the right here. Everything in green is either low likelihood or low consequence, meaning it's a low priority for us. Everything in orange heading towards red, those are our higher risk mains. And those are the ones that we really want to try and get eyes on in some capacity. So that's where we started in trying to say, okay, how do we find a tool that allows us to start that screening process? So the initial main that we identified, it's a 24-inch ductile iron class 51 main that leaves our water treatment plant. It's one of the two main feeds out of our plant. It was installed in 1973, so it's one of our older mains. It hasn't had any failures before, but it does feed a critical industrial customer. We do about 10 million gallons a day out of our treatment facility. We have an industrial chip manufacturer who uses about 3.3 million gallons a day. So they're about a third of our usage. So talk about criticality and wanting to be able to provide them the water that they need. We'd be significantly impacted if that main breaks. So it became a high on our consequence of failure. It was also high on our likelihood of failure. Mostly because it's in corrosive soils, and some of the mains that you see off of here in the city of South Burlington, they had experienced breaks. So there is some break history associated with the mains in the vicinity of this 1.7 miles of run. So we decided to work with Xylem with the Smart Ball to try and identify if there's any leaks there. We also took a whole health check approach and design check to try and identify the comfort level with that main for a long-term sustainability. So we worked with Xylem to put together a pressure monitoring program. The goal there was to try and understand if there's transient pressures that might be impacting the life of the main. With that, we then did a design check. But the most critical one for us was that internal leak detection, trying to find areas where we might have that small leak that we can't find. Hopefully I have it correctly, but from the notes that I had, our recollection is the Smart Ball can go down to about a tenth of a gallon per minute. And that's kind of the level that we were hoping to get down to, that fine level. So we identified some insertion and extraction locations, worked with them to identify tracking locations, and then coordinated what we needed to run the Smart Ball along there. And a couple interesting things here that you might see. I know in Cam's presentation, you saw some nets for the insertion and the extraction through a 4-inch port. We don't have much access to our transmission main. We do have a lot of blow-offs. So we actually came up with and insertion and extraction points being blow-offs, and I'll talk a little bit about that in the next few slides. We also have air release manholes along the way, and we use those for tracking locations, and we also use them for our pressure monitoring. So the other thing that was of interest is we needed to throttle the pipe to get 3 feet per second. I think we might have averaged from 2 to 3 feet when we actually did that. But we also had to close all these little side connections that were off the main, creating about a 4-inch, no more than a 4-inch opening. The other thing we had to do was come up with some contingencies because we were going to blow it out at blow off, and we had the ability to isolate the main if we had to and bring the ball back to the extraction point if for some reason it went past the extraction point. I'll talk about that a little bit more in a second. So to give you a little sense of what the smart ball inspection looked like for us, the 1.7 mile run would be about a day's event. Xylem came up, brought their inspection team up the day before, a couple of days before we were doing the inspection, had a kickoff meeting the next day, installed all the sensors, put the pumping equipment together, and got ourselves all set up and on page to do the inspection. We did the inspection on a Wednesday. We had contingencies for a Thursday if something went wrong. Everything went smoothly, so Thursday wound up actually being a demob day for Xylem. And the actual day of, you can read and kind of see what we did there. But essentially, we got rolling around 7 o'clock in the morning, pumped the ball into the main, tracked it for a while, and around I think we got done around 1:30 when everything was all said and done. About 1 o'clock, we wound up shooting the smart ball out of the extraction point. So to give you a sense of what the experience was like there. Some photos of that day. This golden snitch with no wings looking device here is the smart ball. That gets put into a foam core. We used a pump that we rented to blow the smart ball into the main. So it went into the main under pressure. It went down the length of the main for 1.7 miles. Xylem was able to track it by tracking locations with a computer to see the ball coming and going. That's also a transient pressure monitoring location as well. So there they are above ground tracking the ball as it approaches. And then as it moves away, there were two teams. So they were hopping from point to point to track it. Eventually we got to our blow off. Coming out a throttle down gate valve with a net at the end, blew the foam ball right out of there. The ball came out intact, but once it got into the net, got a little chewed up. And in the end, the smart ball was retrieved, downloaded, and worked very well. It was a pretty efficient operation. So some of the results for us, we took a look at the transient pressure monitoring. We ran it for about a month. Our expected range of operation based on what we have seen historically out there was 40 to 70 PSI. We wound up having about 95% of the samples being between 44 and 75 over that 1 month span. We had some low points in there. Some of those low points correlated to some of the flushing that we were doing locally in the area, as well as also prepping for this work. And so in the end, you get a little bit more granular down to 7-day period. Here we are on the 24th with a little more granularity in there. All in all, these dips and spikes were all pretty much accounted for in different operations that we had intentionally done. So ultimately, the transient pressure monitoring showed that we really weren't seeing surges at this particular location, which is good because we had suspected we might because we have five pumps leaving the plant, pumping water out of the plant. So we thought we might be seeing some surges. So it was good to know that in the end, we weren't really experiencing that. So ultimately, when we ran the design check, this is the thickness required for the surges, the thickness for the external loading, deflection, and what a typical class 150 minimum required thickness is. And our 24 inch in the design check is well above that. Well above any of the minimums we need. So in the end, we are sufficiently designed for the current conditions. One of the other outcomes was, and I know Cam touched on this, from our mapping, we had more of a linear hard line. The mapping showed some sweeping curves, a little bit finer resolution for our mapping program, which was well received. And then ultimately, when we got down to the end, we found no red flags. On one hand, you know, you look to try and want to find something when you put that effort in, but ultimately we realized that it actually was a real positive thing. What we thought might be a real issue for us because of the issues that our mains are seeing in their neighboring systems, we found that we are not in that condition. We don't have any transients, we don't have any leaks or air pockets, so this main doesn't have any issues. And what that does for us is basically says we were prepared to put some efforts into trying to deal with whatever outcome we had if it was a negative outcome. The good news is we were able to look at this main and say we feel pretty good about it, and now we can move on, put our staff resources and our other monetary resources into taking a look at these other mains that are now in that high priority category. And what we do is we then go back and try and readjust the ranking of that main that we originally had as a high consequence of failure, high likelihood of failure. It still has a high consequence of failure, but now we can adjust the likelihood of failure to move that one out of its current ranking. And next we'll jump up to the next main that is on the list, which is our second main that leaves the plant. So we're going to be developing a process for pursuing that one.